Well, hello and welcome to the Eagle and Child podcast. Thank you so much for joining me today. I'm Layla Nahavandi, your host, and I'm super excited to be here with my friend, Pastor Landon MacDonald. Pastor Landon, how are you?
I'm good because you're so positive. Oh my gosh. Were you like the... Did you go to a college where you like had a dorm roommate?
No, I actually lived with a friend. In Australia, we don't really live on campus. So I just rented with a friend in a like little two bedroom apartment.
Okay. Because I just feel like you would be a great college roommate to have someone be this positive. This positive,
thank you.
Would be very helpful in the morning.
Oh, thank you, my friend. Oh, yes. Yeah. And I'm definitely a morning person as well, for sure. Thank you. That's very kind of you. And I wanted to introduce you as well, because for those who don't know you, you are very well known. You're on TheosU, one of my friend's greatest teachers. I know they're always talking about your courses, loving your content and everything that you're doing. But you're also a teaching pastor at Mission Church in Phoenix, Arizona, married to the beautiful Bree, who I got to meet earlier this year at Theos Conference, who is just a legend. She is a million times cooler than I will ever hope to be in my entire life, and just a wonderful person. And you have three beautiful kids as well, awesome content on Instagram as well, which we'll plug a little bit later. But it's great to have you with us, my friend. We're talking about Washington Phillips today.
So you were telling me before we started recording that you have not listened to this guy.
I have never listened to Washington Phillips, or maybe I've heard like the tiniest snippet, but I've never heard of him until you were like, I'm going to do Washington Phillips. I was like, great, that's awesome. But I have no context for him, no background. My theological and historical sort of study has never come across this guy. So I'm super excited to be learning all about him today.
Yes, absolutely. Oh my gosh, this is going to be fantastic. So how do we dive into this guy?
We usually would start with just a bit of a bio. So just how did he become a Christian? What's his life story? What's his background? And sort of just some insight into his spiritual formation, if that's all right.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. This Washington Phillips is an interesting one because, you know, take C.S. Lewis, take any of these guys, and they have so much information about them out there, so many biographies, so much info and stuff. And when you come to a guy like Washington Phillips, up until, you know, the last 20 years, there's just little blurbs in albums and in, you know, press releases, because he wrote and recorded in a level of obscurity that I think really intrigued a lot of people. I've noticed this with my Frank Ocean fandom, which I'm sure people will respect me less as a pastor when I tell them I'm a fan of Frank Ocean, but he chooses to do virtually nothing on social media or interviews. And I think that is extremely cool. Now, obviously, Washington Phillips is not doing this on purpose, because it never happened. But interestingly enough, a guy named Michael Corcoran, who was working for a newspaper in Austin recently, as in like in the last 20 or so years, because Washington Phillips is from like 100 years ago. He had gotten the ability to write the liner notes for this dust to digital record label Washington Phillips set. And he just traveled to East Texas, where Washington Phillips is from, and kind of got a lot of this information, which is cool, because when I first started listening to Washington Phillips, there's like, you just open the CD and it's like, hey, it's this guy, and there's a picture of him, and you know nothing about him, and the music is. So anyways, all of this information has kind of been unearthed. This guy was like legit, going to libraries and like talking to this guy's grandkids and all of this stuff.
Wow, cool.
And I'll get back into that in a sec. But basically, Washington Phillips was African-American pastor in East Texas. He was born in the 1890s, and he lived until 1954. Mm-hmm. And either his parents or his grandparents or his great-grandparents in his line were slaves in America in East Texas. And so when the slaves were freed, his family was freed, and people have said that knew him, that he celebrated Juneteenth every year by roasting an entire pig in his front yard, which is amazing. And he was not an itinerant preacher like you. He was, I think he preached at like three local churches, mm-hmm. because this is like small town, rural America. And I don't think he had any theological training. And he also played music. And so the church that he was, the church that he was at was called, I think, Missionary Baptist Church in some really small town in East Texas, which if you've been in East or West Texas, outside of, you know, Houston, Dallas, and Austin, there is some crazy rural parts of Texas. And so he was just playing music, and he would just hang and play music. And he wrote all these songs, and the music was like blues and gospel. And
cool.
He was writing these blues. They're like blues melodies, you know, like, I don't know if the people listening to this are really into music, but like Robert Johnson is like the classic quintessential like blues guy from around the same time. Mm-hmm. And, you know, blues music like reuses melodies, and they're very predictable. The melodies are very predictable. Like the first time you're listening to it, you like get what's happening, because it's not like built to be surprising. It's built to be like familial and engaging. Like some current hip hop music is like this. Like if you ever listen to a hip hop song and it just sounds exactly like another hip hop song, because they're just using the exact same rhythm of singing, and it's more like a shared, it's like a shared cultural element more than it is like a hyper original melody. So that it has the blues, those blues elements, then it has the gospel elements of obviously the lyrics of the music, which is very Christocentric, very unique, which I'll come back to in a second. But the most interesting part about his music, and the part that most people focus on, is the instrument that he played on, which is he played on, some people say that there's a lot of different, like people say different things about what he played on. Some people call it a celestophone, and some people have described a wooden box that's like the size of a shoebox that he had his hands inside and had hand hammered strings inside that he would pluck with his hands. Other people have described it as a zither, which is what he's holding in the cartoon on the cover of the Keys to the Kingdom compilation from 2005. And it's a zither is like the shape of a harpsichord, and it's like this big, and it just has strings that are tuned, and he's hand plucking them. And they claim that he played two zithers at the same time. And so this is the thing about this music. It is like so familiar with the blues elements and the melodies. And then it's so the zithers that he's playing are like really weird and unique and echoey And so it's mixing these kind of two seemingly disparate elements into something that is extremely, extremely cool. And then, like, he just would, like, play music. This is the thing that I've learned about musicians for Beck. Like, a lot of them, they just played music. And then someone just found them and was like, hey, do you want to record? Because music is awesome. And if that never happened, no one would even know about this person. So as far as I understand. As far as I understand, he was, like, making music for, like, a hot minute. And then someone, like, shows up and is like, hey, let's make this record. So he actually was on Columbia Records, which, as far as I understand, is still the same Columbia Records today. And he made a bunch of songs for them. They were they made singles back then. And so he made a bunch of what are called shellac singles, which is kind of like the precursor to vinyl. If you've ever seen, it is a vinyl, but it's like made of a different material. Like, and they're 10 inches, not 12 or 7, typically, like a vinyl. But if you've ever seen, one of those, I used to have one of these, like, things are like this big and you like wind it up and you play it. It doesn't even need to be plugged in. And then you put the needle down on the top. It's like an auto player, but it's like the size of like an armoire.
Yeah. Like, is it a gramophone or?
Exactly. Like that. Yeah, that's like typically playing like a shellac record. Oh my gosh. Okay. I must sound so navel-gazy right now. I'm like, so
that's cool. I'm excited. I love
so
it.
So interested in like the most minute details of things. And so he made these shellac records. There was, I think, like 7 or 8 of them, and they all had an A side and a B side. And that's it. That's the music. And then it kind of faded from obscurity. There's, you know, a lot of cool record labels like Dust to Digital or like Light in the Attic or some other ones that basically just find old music and release it. You know, they find it. Like, here's an example of something I actually was just looking at. I have it on my desk. It's this thing called Take Me to the Water, and it is vintage photography of baptisms from 1890 to 1950 in America. And then in the back,
that is so cool.
It's so sick. And then in the back, there is like a CD, and they may even have a Washington Phillips song on it. I'm not sure. But that was the way that he first kind of got into any sort of public consciousness around now. There was a release that I have at home. I should have brought it with me, but it wouldn't have been really cool to look at because I've kept my copy sealed because I'm the worst. And it's a set called Goodbye Babylon. And it's
cool name.
It's like a wooden box and it has 6 CDs of classic out of print gospel music. And so someone had found one of these Washington Phillips shellacs and they loved it. And so then they got it on this compilation. And that's then so cool. Other people heard this song and they were like, we want more of this. And then they found, let's go track these down. And so they, who is this guy? If you can imagine that, like, we know everything that we want to know. So like you like an artist, you can, you know, be looking at what they did today within 60 seconds.
What they ate for breakfast. Yeah.
Exactly. We have a staggering amount of ability to be not actually close, but kind of the perception of closeness to artists that we like. So people are listening to this song. They're like, who is this guy? Type in his name on Google. Nothing. There's just nothing there. There's nothing, no one knows anything. It's just lost to history. So people went and wanted to make these compilations. And his first single that he released was, I think it was Denomination Blues. And that one sold 8,000 copies, which I would have no way of knowing if that is a lot or a little at that time period. It sounds like a lot to me for a person who doesn't, no one knows who they were at least 25 years ago. And so people went and found these and tracked these down at various record stores. I'm sure a lot of them were scratched or destroyed. And they found good copies of them, made copies of them. And then they released these compilations of it. And then he kind of has attained this, like, I mean, he's not like popular, but he has attained this kind of intriguing cult status. So they had released this label called Agram Blues, released Denomination Blues, the compilation in the 1970s. And then the popularity kind of went a little bit more from there. And the one I had was from 2005, and it's on this Yazoo record label, and it's called The Key to the Kingdom, and that's the name of one of his songs. And that was the one that I was listening to in college, like maybe, I don't know, like 15 years ago or something. Like, to put it in context, he has 30,000 monthly listeners on Spotify. So he's not popular at all. Like, he's remarkably unpopular. but if you're listening to this, and you're looking for music that is artistically extremely interesting and also very worshipful and compelling, I would consider Washington Phillips to be one of the best on that. And then as the final piece of the bio, forgive me if I've talked for too long, is that he has been covered by artists.
No, this is great. So interesting.
Yeah. He was covered by Mogwai, which is a British, Scottish, forgive me. You have to say that one right. A Scottish post-rock band. He was covered by the jam band Fish, and he was covered by Mavis Staples, who's one of my favorite gospel singers. And so, yeah, that's a little bit, on the guy.
Awesome. That's so great, Landon. So can you tell us maybe a little bit about what are some big works that he's known for? I know you mentioned he was a pastor. Is there anything that he sort of did that was significant that we know of? I know we really don't have a lot of information on him, but what is he known for?
Just for this is all. And this Michael Corcoran guy had gone to East Texas because someone had looked at the public records and found that a person named Washington Phillips died in a mental institution in the 1930s in Austin. Whoa. And so someone had printed that was the same guy, which is obviously very sad. Whoa. And very interesting. But then this guy who's this researcher, he went to East Texas and found out that that was actually Washington Phillips' brother or cousin, and it was not him, which is really sad. I mean, it's just like, that's a pretty big piece of information to have printed about you after you're dead. And it was not true. And so it was actually true that he died of normal circumstances in 1954. You know, people can't resist a story. So his most significant work is these songs. They've all been released. There's nothing unreleased. There's nothing like there, you know, and there are 20 tracks on my favorite compilation, which is The Key to the Kingdom, which is on Spotify and all of that stuff. And it's pretty cool. It's like a mix. Like, he has a song called Paul and Silas in Jail, just like very Bible, like a Bible.
I love
Bible
all these titles.
Yeah.
These titles sound so cool. Like, I feel like I would love his lyrics. Even if I wouldn't love the music, I know I would love the lyrics because they just all sound like so spectacular.
Dude, I know. We need to tell Nathan and Gabe Finocchio about this guy because he literally has a song called The Church Needs Good Deacons.
Let's go. Could be the soundtrack for the next Theos conference.
It's like the most like logistically pleasing to an organizational person worship song of all time. He has but probably my two favorite songs of his. He has just a prayer song, and it's called Take Your Burden to the Lord and Leave It There. And it's a beautiful prayer song. It's a meditation, and the lyrics are, let me see if I can remember. Take your burden to the Lord and leave it there. If you trust him and never doubt, he will surely lead you out. And very simple, you know, we're not talking like Emily Dickinson, like William Wordsworth stuff. This is like, this is folk music. So these are like, you know, it's not like, you know, Radiohead obscure poetry. I like stuff like that, but this is like right from the heart, stunning poetry. And then the the other song that I really like is called "What Are They Doing in Heaven Today?" And
cool. What a cool thought.
It is so cool, isn't it? It's like so creative. It's so artistic to me that he just is like saying it's what the Psalms feel like to me. Like when I'm reading the Psalms, I'm like, this is so weird. Like, it's so weird that it says in this worship song, it's like unity is like oil running down Aaron's beard. I get what that means hermeneutically, but compared to like worship music, it's so weird and obscure. And I just love it. It's so like not well-rounded and not fit for the masses. And that's like some of the stuff on here. I was in an electronic Christian band when I was in college because I was like desperately trying to like tie together all of the things that I felt into like one unified whole, which was unsuccessful, but it was
very cool.
It was fruitful.
Did you play sing, or what was your role?
I wrote music. I wrote the songs, and then I would get singers to play with me, and I had a whole band. One time I did it just me DJing and a singer, but I did all the way up to like a 7-piece band with a 3-piece gospel harmony section, and it was like
cool.
That was something. I don't know. It was fun. I had a lot of fun doing it. But the reason I bring that up is because one, we covered the song "What Are They Doing in Heaven Today?" It struck me so much, this idea. And I heard it in your voice when I said the idea out loud. You caught the idea, which is like, wow, what an interesting idea, which is something we're all trying to do when we're writing content or delivering content or speaking to people is, you know, we can walk up on stage and say, Jesus died on the cross for our sins. And that's true. But how many people are listening or captivated by that? That is a captivating idea. It's the most beautiful idea in the entire world. But we're responsible not just for like saying truth out loud, but also delivering it to people in a way that they can understand, that's creative, that's excellent, that's exciting. And so anyways, that is what I feel about that song.
So beautiful. Yeah, I feel like just every title that you've mentioned, obviously I don't really know anything about him, but that every title that you've mentioned, every lyric, anything, it's just like mind-blowing. And I think, yeah, as you said, that's a mark of a true artist. And I think as Christians as well, it's like Holy Spirit inspired creativity, which is really cool. So that's really cool for like some big things. Is there anything that you would say that he has sort of done to influence the church throughout history? Did he sort of change the game in his time? Or do you think it's maybe more so that, you know, he was relatively unknown and God's sort of just like lighting a fire to his stuff now, and he sort of had a legacy after the fact?
Yeah.
What was his impact like in his time, do you think?
I think very little. I think very small. And I think there's something beautiful about that. I'm a big fan of the artist Nick Drake, who's a folk singer from the 60s and 70s, and he was pretty remarkably unpopular until someone used his song in a Volkswagen ad in 2001, and then he was on the Garden State soundtrack, but he had already been dead for 30 years. And I think that there is something beautiful for artists about not measuring the success of what you're doing based on the current amount that people are listening or care, but rather based on how good and excellent it is, which I think
I love that.
The excellence of something is the greatest measure, and God can choose what to use it for.
Totally. I love that. That's so inspiring. So then following on from that, what would you say he can teach the church of today, or Christians or artists of today? Are there sort of key things that you think we can take away from his life and his example?
Layla's gone, so I'm just going to sit here and listen to Washington Phillips. This is his song called Honey in the Rock.
Okay, well, sorry, guys. We're having a few little issues with our recording at the moment, but that's all we have from Pastor Landon MacDonald on Washington Phillips. If you want to follow Pastor Landon MacDonald, he has some great content on Instagram and also on YouTube. So you definitely want to have a look at that. He is at, I think, I am Landon MacDonald on Instagram, and then Pastor Landon on YouTube as well. Lots of great content out there, biblical content, stuff for you to connect with and connect with him as well. Thank you so much for joining me today on the Eagle and Child podcast. I'll see you next time. Bye. Thanks so much for tuning into the Eagle and Child podcast. That's all from us for today. If you want to support us, you can like, subscribe, or drop us a review. And don't forget to follow us on Instagram at Eagle and Child podcast. We'll catch you next time. Much love.